These letters were sent in 1855 by Native American Chief Seattle of the Duwamish Tribe to Franklin Pierce, President of the United States, in response to an offer to purchase the Duwamish lands in the northeast of the U.S., currently Washington State. The Native Americans were powerfully bound to the earth. The idea of property was strange to them, and they actually considered the earth to own humankind. This was the chief's moving lucid letter. The great chief in Washington sent words that he wished to buy our land. The great chief also sent us words of friendship and goodwill. This is kind of him, since we know he has little need of our friendship in return. But we will consider your offer, for we know if we do not so, the white man may come with guns and take our land. What Chief Seattle says you can count on, as truly as our white brothers can count on the return of the season. My words are like the star, they do not set. How can you buy or sell the sky, the worm or the land? The idea is strange to us. Yet, we do not own the freshness of the air or the sparkle of the water. How can you buy them from us? We will decide in our time. Every part of this earth is sacred to my people. Every shining pine needle, every sandy shore, every mist in the dark woods, every clearing, and every homing insect is holy in the memory and experience of my people. The sap that runs through the trees carries the memories of the red skinned man. The dead among the white man forget their birthplace when they live to wall among the stars. Our dead never forget this beautiful earth because she is the red man's mother. We are part of the earth and she is part of us. The scented flowers are our sister, the horny beast, the horse, and the majesty eagle are our brothers. The fields, the warm body of the fowl and man all belong to the same family. Thus, when the great chief in Washington sends word that he wished to buy our lands, he is asking for a great deal. The great chief sends word that he will reserve a space for us to live comfortable with each other. He will be our father and we will be his children. Because of this, we will consider his offer to buy our lands. But this will not be easy, because these lands are sacred to us. The sparkling water that runs in the rivers and streams is not only water. It is the blood of our ancestors. If we sell you these lands, you must remember that they are sacred, and teach your children that they are, and that every ghostly reflection in the clear waters of the lakes speak of the lives and memories of the life of my people. The murmur of the stream is the voice of my father's father. The rivers are our sister and quell our thirst. The rivers carry our canoes and feed our children. If we sell you our lands, you must remember and teach your children that the rivers are our kin and your kin. You must henceforth treat the rivers as kindly as you would your brothers and sisters. We know that the white man doesn't understand our ways. One portion of land is the same to him as the next, for he is a stranger who comes in the night and takes from the land whatever he needs. The earth is not his brother, but his enemy, and when he has conquered it, he moves on. He leaves his father's graves, and his children's birthright is forgotten. He strips the earth from his children and cares not. He forgets his father's stone, and he and the rights of his children. He treats his mother the earth and his brother the heavens as if they were things that could be bought, plundered and sold, and so they were lamps and glass beads. His insatiable hunger will devour the earth and leave behind a desert. I do not understand. Our ways are different to yours. The sight of your cities pains the eyes of the red man. Or perhaps it is because the red man is a savage and doesn't understand. There is no quiet place in the white man's city. No place to listen to the leaves of spring or the rustle of insect wings. But perhaps because I am a savage and do not understand, the clatter only seems to insult the ears. And what is there to life if a man cannot hear the lovely cry of the whippoorwill, or the arguments of the frogs around a pond at night? I am a red man, I don't understand. The Indian prefers the soft sound of the wind itself, cleansed by a midday rain, or scented by a pinon pine. The air is precious to the red man, for all things share the same breath, the bees, the trees, and the man. The white man doesn't seem to notice the air he breathes. Like a man dying for many days, he is known to the stench. If we sell you our lands, you must remember that the air is precious to us, that the air shares its spirit with all the life it sustains. And if we sell you our lands, you must set them aside and keep them sacred as a place that even the white man may go to taste the wind sweetened by the flowers in the grassland. If I decided to accept your offer, I will make one condition. The white man must treat the beasts of his land as his brothers. I am a savage, and I don't understand any other way. I have seen thousands of rotting buffaloes on the prairie, led by the white man, who shot them from a passing train. I am a savage, I don't understand how the smoking iron horse can be more important than the buffalo that we kill only to stay alive. What is man without the beast? If all the beasts were gone, men would die from great loneliness of spirit. For whatever happens to the beast also happens to the man. All things are connected. Whatever befalls the earth befalls the sons of the earth. You must teach your children that the ground beneath their feet is the arch of their grandparents. In order that they may respect the earth, teach them that the earth is full of the life of our ancestors. You must teach your children while we have taught ours, that the earth is our mother. Everything that affects the earth affects the sons of the earth. When men spit on the ground, they spit on themselves. We know this. The earth doesn't belong to man. Man belongs to the earth. Man has no woven the net of life. He is just a thread in it. Everything he does to this net, he does to himself. What befalls the earth will befall the sons of the earth. We know this. All things are bound up in each other like the blood that binds the family. Even the wise man, whose God walks with him and speaks with him, cannot be excluded from a common destiny. We may even be brothers in the land. We will see. One thing we know, that the wise man may one day discover. Our God is the same God. You may think that you own him as you wish to own our land, but you cannot. He is the body of man, and his compassion is equal for the red man and the white. This earth is precious to him, and to harm the earth is to heap contempt on its creator. The wise too shall pass, perhaps sooner than other tribes. Continue to contaminate your bed, and you will one night suffocate your own ways. But even in your last hours, you will feel illuminated by the idea that God brought you to these lands and gave you a special purpose and ownership over them and over the red man. When the buffalo are all slaughtered, the wild horses all tanned, the sacred corners of the forest heavy with the scent of many men, and the beauty of the rye hills blowed by the talking wires, where is the thicket? Gone. Where is the eagle? Gone. What is to say goodbye to the sweet and the horn? The end of living and the beginning of survival.